15 minutes. So technically there was some problem. So okay, never mind. Now continue the class.
Pranam Maharaj, Swami Maharaj, Jai Shri Ramakrishna.
Yeah, it's all the will of the Lord. Nothing happens without His will. Om Sthapakaya cha Dharmasya Sarva Dharma Swarupine Avatara Varishthaya Ramakrishnaya Te Namaha. So we had stopped our meeting last time. We had gone to Rameshwaram with the father of Sri Ramakrishna. We had all visited Rameshwaram. We were seeing Rameshwaram. We were knowing about Rameshwaram in the last class. Then after that, I told you about the pilgrimage of Rameshwaram, how every Hindu has to visit Rameshwaram. It's one of the Jyotirlingas. Then from there, we have to carry the sand of the sea near Rameshwaram to Kashi, and it has to be put there. And the Kashi, from Kashi, the Ganga water has to be bought, and it has to be bathed on the Shivalingam in Rameshwaram. So this is the tradition. So every Hindu will be asked to do it. It's the duty of every Hindu to do that. So we saw that pilgrimage. At least if we had not gone on pilgrimage, through the father of Sri Ramakrishna, we are now doing the pilgrimage. We had done that pilgrimage now. At least it is sometimes very difficult for all Hindus to go on such a long pilgrimage because of their busy schedule. So now through Ramakrishna, we had gone to that pilgrimage. Now we will again enter back to the study of life before the advent of Sri Ramakrishna, the surroundings in Kamarpukur, the parentage and other things. Now going forward, let us see. Sridharam now in 1826, he had another child. He gave birth to Chandra Devi, the mother of Ramakrishna, gave birth to another son in AD 1826. In memory of his recent pilgrimage, Sridharam named his son Rameshwar. Last time I told the story of Ajamila, how in Hinduism we are supposed to keep the name of the Lord, so that each time by telling the name of our children, then we can remember God in that way. So even Ajamila, by mistake, by chance, he called his son's name as Narayana, and the messengers of death had come. They were chased away because he repeated Narayana at the time of death. And from Vaikuntha, the messengers of Vishnu came, chased away the messengers of death and took him to Vaikuntha. We saw that. So that is the reason parents in India name their children the name of God, so that they'll be always telling the name. And many of the parents, not knowing all these things, they will change, they will make it short, the beautiful name given by the parents, because they want to please some master, some other British people or some English people, Western people. They shorten the name and take away the benefit of repeating the name of the Lord. So we shall keep in mind and then do the needful. Now, we are preparing for the advent. We are now entering to the life of Sridharam. So we are all now ready to receive Sri Ramakrishna. The next 8 years showed little change in the tenor of life of the poor family at Kamarpukur. Ram Kumar, the eldest son, now earned money by advising people on religious matters on the authority of Smritis and by performing various religious ceremonies. He had taken the duty of a priest. So, in consequence, the family was more affluent than before. He became an expert in the performance of those rites and is said to have obtained a supernatural power to make them effective. Now, Ram Kumar became an expert in the performance of all these Hindu rituals and rites and he is said to have obtained a supernatural power to make them effective. Study of the scriptures had given him faith in the worship of Shakti. So worshipping Divine Mother, worshipping God, who is formless, who is attributeless, as Mother is worship of God as Shakti. That is there in Hinduism. We have so many ways by which we can approach the Lord. So this is also one important approach, how we can establish relationship with God, who is formless, who is attributeless, who is so infinite. So this is to see, look at God as Divine Mother, Mother, our own Mother. So that is worship of Shakti, the primordial divine power personified. Now, Ram Kumar had also received initiation in the mantra of Shakti from a competent teacher. Now, many of you have received initiation from your guru, from the presidents and vice presidents of Ramakrishna order. So they gave the mantra so that we can progress forward in spiritual life. That is called mantra diksha, spiritual initiation. So like that, because at that time there was no Ramakrishna order for Ramakumar to receive any spiritual initiation. So now he had received initiation in the mantra of Divine Mother, Shakti, from a competent teacher. He had a wonderful vision one day. He had a wonderful vision, darshan, one day while worshipping this goddess, his chosen deity. So now the Guru has given him the Divine Mother Shakti as the chosen deity. So he had a wonderful vision one day while he was worshipping this goddess. His chosen deity, Divine Mother, he felt as if the Divine Mother was marking the letters of some mantra. As if the Divine Mother, in that vision, he saw the Divine Mother is marking the mantras. The chosen ideal herself has come now in the vision, and she is marking the letters of some mantra with her own fingers on the tip of his tongue. So now that Divine Mother, the Ishta Devata of Ram Kumar, she is marking the letters of some mantra with her own fingers on the tip of his tongue. This experience made him perfect in astrology. So this vision, this darshan, whereby the Divine Mother herself came and started writing some mantra, marking some mantra on the tongue of Ramakumar with her own hands. So that made him perfect in the science of astrology. This experience made him perfect in astrology. Henceforward, whatever he predicted, whatever Ramakumar predicted would come true. Simply by looking at a patient, he could know whether he would be cured or not. He acquired some fame in those parts for correct prediction of future events. It is said that on seeing a person suffering from a severe disease, he would start performing propitiatory rites for his recovery and would say emphatically, as soon as the grains I am now sprinkling over the place of worship begin to sprout, this person will recover. So now many people who are not acquainted with the way, maybe 200 years back, 150 years back, when there was no medical science. Medical science had its own way in the form of Ayurveda, and so many other systems were there. But how people would depend upon God for even curing diseases? What were the way? They would try, because all of our problems, misery and diseases are due to karmas. So by doing propitiatory rites, they would feel that all that karma which has caused the disease or problem would go away. So now you can see how they used to depend upon God for everything. So we can study the way they approach the problems of life in those days, 200 years back in India, 150 years back in India, how without any medical science, how without any help of any other special system to cure the problems or diseases, how the approach was there, you can get an idea. Otherwise, you'll be confused. What happened in India? How were they overcoming it? You know, mind is a very strong person in our system. That mind, whatever suggestions you give, because all the diseases, everything, every problem can be healed. Any problems, any disease can be healed by our mind, because our body is the one which is curing by immunity. So it is the body, the medicines and other things, doctors are only a help. But in reality, all the diseases are cured by our own bodies. So here, they developed a special science whereby when you do these propitiatory rites and other things, the mind would feel, it would go deep inside, it would create faith. Now my diseases will vanish. So how? The body will now overcome that and diseases will go away. So maybe some more deeper science may be there. I could explain only to this extent. So we shall see, we shall study, we can understand how people 200 years back in India, 150 years back in India, when there was no science, when there was no medical science, it is not developed. So how were they approaching the problems of life? So how they were dependent upon God for everything? So now we shall see how people used to, by this study of Ramakumar's way of dealing the things, henceforward, whatever he predicted would come true. Simply by looking at a patient, he could know whether he would be cured or not. He acquired some fame in those parts for correct prediction of future events. It is said that on seeing a person suffering from a severe disease, he would start performing propitiatory rites for his recovery and would say emphatically, as soon as the grains I am now sprinkling over the place of worship begins to sprout, this person will recover. And as a matter of fact, what he said would actually come true. His nephew, Shivaram Chattopadhyaya, told us the following story as an illustration of his power. Being in Calcutta on business, Ramakumar was bathing in the Ganga one morning, when a rich man and his family also came for the bath. The man's wife was seated in a palanquin. I think you may be knowing about palanquin. In those days, it was a mode of transport because they didn't have the vehicle, the motorized vehicles or some such thing. So when people used to move, then there would be a wooden palanquin, so in which one or two people could sit, the king or anybody, rich people would travel by this palanquin. So there would be bearers, four or five servants would be there. So two in the front, two in the back, or one in the front or one in the back, depending upon the weight of the palanquin and the people inside. So they would carry that palanquin. That was the mode of transportation for the rich people and also even to the kings. So that is called palanquin. Nowadays, you can see that palanquin in ritual in the temple. So the deity is carried and also the sacred books are carried or some other sacred things are carried in that palanquin. You can see if you go to some old traditional temples, that system is still preserved. So if you go to the Belur Math Museum also, you can see the palanquin there, placed there for us to see. So you can see those things in the museum. So if this system would provide us to show some slides, PPT and other things, I think if our people here, volunteers can do the research, if we can show the PPT, I would have bought it from the Google or something and showed you the picture, a video or a photograph, something could be shown. I don't know whether our volunteers have done the research to show the PPT or the pictures. So now he would tell, as soon as now we are going back, being in Calcutta on business, Ram Kumar was bathing in Ganga one morning when a rich man and his family also came for a bath. The man's wife was seated in a palanquin, which was taken to the river so that she could take a bath inside it. So the palanquin itself was taken to the river. The people would be holding there. She was made provision to take bath from the palanquin itself so that no other people outside can see her. So that thing was provided, and Ram Kumar, who was also taking bath, noticed this peculiar thing. So now the palanquin itself was taken to the river so that that rich lady could take a bath inside the palanquin. Coming as he did, that is Ram Kumar, from the village, had never seen a woman bathing in the way protected from public gaze. Looking at the palanquin with wonder, he happened to catch sight of the woman's face for a moment. He instantly knew through his supernatural power that she would die the next day, and was so overcome by the thought that he could not help muttering sadly to himself, "Alas, the body which today is being bathed with such propriety will tomorrow be immersed as a corpse in the very same Ganga and disposed of in the sight of everybody." The rich man overheard this, and in order to test the truth of his words, pressed Ram Kumar to come to his house. His real intention was to teach him a good lesson in case his prediction proved false. The young woman was in perfect health, and there was no indication whatsoever at that time of such a mishap. But since what Ram Kumar had predicted actually came to pass, the man finally could not but let him go in peace. So it happened the very next day, that young lady who was so healthy and perfect, because it is not because of the prediction of Ram Kumar that she died, but Ram Kumar had a special power. By seeing the person, any person, he could tell what is going to happen in future. That was the power. So there are two kinds of power. If you start telling truth in your words, we all know telling the truth in our words, then what is the truth in deed and in thought? You should be truthful not only in your words, but you should be truthful in your thought and deed too. So, kaya, vacha, manasa. If you practice truthfulness in this way for 12 years, our Yoga Shastra tells that you will develop such a power whereby whatever you predict will become truth. Whatever you tell, you cannot predict anything wrong. So that is the power you get if you start practicing truthfulness in thought, word and deed. So here, Ram Kumar, by the grace of the Divine Mother who he was worshipping, Shakti Aradhana, and also that Divine Mother had written something on his tongue, one mantra, with her own fingers. So he had developed a special supernatural power by which he could see any person, he could predict what would happen in his life. Now, seeing the face of that young lady taking bath in Ganga in that form, he muttered to himself. What did he mutter? "Alas, the body which today is being bathed with such propriety will tomorrow be immersed as a corpse in the Ganga and disposed of in the sight of all." So the rich man overheard it, and he wanted to punish him if the prediction would be wrong. So he took him to his house, but it was found true the next day that young lady was in perfect health. She passed away. Then next we will see what happened, what were his prediction and what were the supernatural powers which Ramakumar had. Once looking into his wife's future, his own wife's future, Ramakumar made a sad prediction, which unfortunately proved true afterwards. She is said to have had auspicious marks from the very day he married her and brought her to his home. The wheel of fortune took a favorable turn for the family. She was then 7 years old. 200 years back, why even in some places in India, the child marriage, though the government has issued strict rules and regulation that children, girls cannot be married off below 18 and men cannot marry below the age of 21. But still the child marriage practice, which has come from long, so many people in the villages, they do that. So it is happening in India. So it was very popular in those days. We are, because studying the society 200 years back, so you'll be wondering what kind of practice are all these things. So we have to go back to 200 years. Then only we can understand, sympathize with them. So now this girl was married to Ramakumar. She was then 7 years old. And the marriage took place probably in AD 1820. So you can see it is 1820. Now we are in 2020. So you can also become great astrologers to predict how many years back this happened. It was from this time that the improvement in his father's circumstances began. For it was just then that the monthly help from his nephew Ramchandra of Medinipur began to come in. Naturally, any daughter-in-law who thus brings good luck to your family on becoming its member is looked upon with love and respect. Moreover, since Ramakumar's child wife was then the only daughter-in-law of the family. So Ramakumar's wife was the only daughter-in-law of the family. So naturally, everybody started showing a lot of love and affection. It's but natural. And she was very young, a girl of 7. So it was not surprising that everyone made much of her. We were told that in spite of her good qualities, too much of indulgence and attention made her touchy and obstinate. So we can learn from this. If we pamper our children too much, so then what will you make of those children? So now we can see it. Too much of indulgence and too much of attention made her touchy and obstinate. So the same applies to any children. We have to show love and affection to our children wherever it is necessary. We have to discipline them. We have to teach them good manners, good character. Otherwise, if we go on pampering them, the same thing is going to happen, bound to happen. So too much of an indulgence and attention made her touchy and obstinate. But although these defects were noticed by all, no one ventured either to mention them or to correct her. For everyone overlooked her little defects, remembering that she had brought prosperity to the family since the day of her coming. But when she was grown up, Ramakumar one day looked at her and predicted that although she had auspicious marks, now Ramakumar is predicting, although she has auspicious marks, she would die if she should ever conceive. The moment she would conceive a child, then she will die. That was the prediction given by Ramakumar. When he found, however, that she did not conceive for several years, he thought that she was barren and felt relieved. But at the age of 35, she did conceive. So that wife of Ram Kumar, everybody thought that she was barren, and the prediction that if she conceives, she will die. So the, now they thought that she is barren, she will not have any issues, so she will not die. But at the age of 35, she did conceive, and the following year, AD 1849, she passed away after giving birth to a very beautiful male child. The boy was named Akshaya Kumar. Chronologically, this incident comes much later, but we have narrated it here for the sake of convenience. Now, going forward, a peculiar characteristic of a divine and subtle kind was shared by everyone of Shudhiram's pious household. It is probably because of the dominance of this character in Shudhiram and his wife that it was inherited by their children, since we have already mentioned several instances of it relating to Shudhiram. It will not be out of place if we relate here a similar event regarding Chandramani Devi. This will show how Chandramani Devi also, like her husband, saw divine visions from time to time. So this was a very pious family, religious family. They were so simple. So it's but natural, because of their simplicity and purity, that they would have spiritual visions, darshans, now and then. And also you should imagine they are going to give birth the divine child who will become the great teacher of the world, who is Avatar Purusha, who is considered to be the avatar of Narayana Vishnu. So then you can see the purity and the greatness of the parents. So it's but natural such parents would have spiritual visions, darshans of various gods and goddesses now and then. This incidence will show how Chandramani, also like her husband, saw divine visions from time to time. The event took place shortly before Ram Kumar was married. The 15-year-old boy, that is Ram Kumar, was then studying in a Sanskrit school and at the same time trying to help the family by performing worship in various houses. Now, Ram Kumar was not only studying, at the same time, he is trying to help the parents by earning some money and sending it to the parents. So you can see children in India, at the age of 15, they would take up. So until then, it was childhood. As soon as they become youths, that was the custom in India. They would help the parents to run the family. Nowadays, we can see that for a long time, parents have to support the children until they have finished the education. But here and some other countries, we can see that once they come to the age of 18, they just leave the parents and go away. They will start their own house. They will start everything their own way. But in India, you can see that the parents would support the children. At the same time, the children, it was a custom, it was a duty that the children, once they come to their youth, it is not just enjoyment, just not materialistic enjoyment. They used to help the parents. They had a lot of duties. They had a lot of responsibilities towards the parent. See, if you make all these things to be known by our children, if we give Ramayana, if we give Mahabharata, and other great epics, we can see wonderful characters there. How Rama was so respectful to his father. He was ready to give up anything, his kingdom. He would become the king next day just because of the words of his father. just went to the forest, gave up everything. Then we study the life of Shravana Kumara in Ramayana, how great he was, how much he loved his father and mother. He served them, he took them to the pilgrimage. Every second, every 24/7, he would be serving his father and mother, old father and mother. He used to carry them on his shoulders. So when you read, when the children are exposed at the young age to all these stories, then they will also develop that pure love, unconditional devotion toward their parents. We are not giving them. Then we are seeing so many old ages and so many ill treatment of the children towards their parents. So we have to give all these things. We have to teach our children all these beautiful things so that when they hear, it goes to their subconscious mind. And then they will start emulating that, inculcating those teachings. So now here you can see Akshay Kumar, even though he was studying in the Sanskrit college, in the Sanskrit school at the age of 15, he at the same time also was working and earning some money, not for himself, not for his joy, enjoyments, but to help his parents. This is responsibility. So that attitude of service to the parents should be inculcated. It was natural in India in those times that it was their bounden duty. They used to look after father and mother as veritable manifestation of God. So we have seen that in India. I have seen in our Purvashrama. Purvashrama means in our family life. Though I am a sannyasin, I can't speak of my Purvashrama. Just to give an example, I have seen my own Purvashrama brother, my pre-monastic brother, used to earn money. He used to go to the office, used to do the work there and bring the salary on first. And he would not take one single pie. He would give that all that money to the mother. And if he wanted something, he would take the money from the mother, ask if he wanted anything to spend the money for his own needs. I have seen with my own eyes. He would give all the money to the mother. And the mother was the caretaker. Though she was not highly educated, though the elder son was very educated, and the mother was not so educated. She was a housewife. But all the money, the salary he would get, he would give to the mother. And the mother would keep it and spend it for all that of the family. And she was also so unselfish, just for the welfare of the family. Everybody's thought was the welfare of the family, of each of the family members. We've seen that. So that was common in India. So that is gradually now going away, but still by the grace of God, such values are still can be seen in India even now. Here also in some of parts of South Africa and other places, we can see those values in the Indian families, whatever it might be. So we have to teach our children these values slowly. If you try to force or impose, then it may not come. But if you expose them to such stories, tell beautiful stories, making the children sit on the lap and see, Ram Kumar did this, he was doing that, it will go into his mind, then he will start imitating. So we have to expose children to such stories, such things. So this event took place shortly before Ram Kumar was married. The 15-year-old boy was then studying in a Sanskrit school and at the same time trying to help the family by performing worship in various houses. So he was working at the same time and earning little money so that he can support the family, help the parents. So once in the month of Ashwin, Ram Kumar, I told you earlier, the Indian calendar, we have the Jyeshtha, Vaishakha, Ashwini, all these things are month, Indian months. So once in the month of Ashwin, Ram Kumar had gone to a house at Burshubo to perform the evening worship of the goddess Lakshmi. So he had gone to do the worship of Divine Mother Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth, to perform the evening worship of the goddess of Lakshmi. He had gone to another village, Burshubo. When her son did not return home, though it was part of midnight, Chandramani Devi became very restless. and coming out of the house, waited for him anxiously. You can also see the love of the mother towards the child. She is concerned, she is anxious. The child has gone to do the worship. He's a well-grown adult now, more than 15 years. So there is nothing to worry. And it was village, no, nothing can happen, no crime, nothing. So that too, it is 200 years back. But still, she's so anxious, so much of love, so much of care. They would pray, they would do, the mothers would do vrata, they would do japas, they would do pujas for the welfare of the children, welfare of the husband. So that is the way they would be praying to the Lord. So that's how they used to express their love towards their near and dear ones. So now, when her son did not return home, though it was part of midnight, Chandramani became very restless and kept coming out of the house, waited for him anxiously, while looking in the direction from which he was to come. She was sitting there outside the house, looking towards the direction from which that village Burshubo. So from that direction he is supposed to come. So she started looking, gazing outside in the midnight. She is not sleeping because she is concerned for the child, her child. She was waiting for him anxiously while looking in the direction from which he was to come. She saw now a lone figure approaching by the field path. You know, it was all village. And everywhere you can see the paddy field, trees and other things. So from the side of that field path, so there would be one or two main roads, that's all. That too, it would not be metalled, it would be mud road. But most of them would have shortcuts. They would not use these roads. They used to walk in between the paddy fields. There would be no fencing because there was no stealing. Nobody would destroy anybody's crop. They would be so good by nature that nobody will steal anybody's crop. Or even if you come through their property, nobody will object. There will be no fences. So they wish to make the field and the agricultural field, the paddy field itself, in between the path would be used for walking shortcuts. They wish to walk through the fields itself. Since long, this practice was there. Nowadays, people have become so selfish. Everywhere compounds, everywhere this thing, so much of crime. So all these things have come now in those days in India. So they used to walk through the fields. The field may belong to anybody, the paddy field and anything. So there would be no fencing. So anybody could walk through the field. Now she saw Chandramani Devi, a figure, lone figure, approaching by the field path leading from Burshubo to Kamarpukur. That to midnight. Thinking that it was her son, she went a few steps forward in great joy to meet him. When the person drew nearer, she found that it was not Ram Kumar, but a very beautiful girl, bedecked with various ornaments. A beautiful girl, bedecked with many beautiful ornaments, various ornaments. As Chandramani was full of anxiety for the safety of her son, the sight of a respectable girl walking thus at dead of the night did not strike her as something strange. Because now when you are in normal condition, you can think of what is the time now. This is a small girl, young girl, with so much of ornaments. She's walking that too in the midnight. All those thoughts will come when you are in normal circumstance. Now Chandramani Devi is worried about the child, her son Ram Kumar, was supposed to come from that village, Burshubo, walking. So no other thought. Her thought was only focused on her child, Ram Kumar. So now, as Chandra Devi was full of anxiety for the safety of her son, the sight of a respectable girl walking thus at dead of the night did not strike her as something strange. She just went up to her and called out, "Where do you come from, my child?" The girl answered, from Bursugo. Chandradevi then asked her anxiously, did you meet my son Ramkumar? She's a stranger and a young girl bedecked with so much of ornaments. She's coming from that village Burshubo, okay? She's telling, I've come from Burshubo. But how should she know Ramkumar? All that thought didn't cross. She was just thinking, focusing her thought on her child, that is Ramkumar. Where do you come from, my child? The girl answered, from Burshubo. Chandradevi then asked her anxiously, did you meet my son Ramkumar? Is he coming back? It did not strike her mind even for a moment how an absolute stranger like this girl could possibly know her son. The girl replied, comforting her, I come from the very house, note this point, I come from the very house where your son went to perform the worship. He had gone to worship Mother Lakshmi. I'm coming from the very house from which your son has gone to worship. So you can imagine who that girl is. I come from the very house where your son went to worship, perform the worship. Do not worry. He will return soon. Hearing this, Chandramani Devi felt relieved and became more observant. Now the anxiety is gone because she got good news about her son Ramkumar. She has come from the same house where Ramkumar was performing the worship. Do not worry, he is safe, he is coming back. So now her mind came to the normal thing, circumstance. Now all her worry is gone about her child. Now she started thinking about this girl. All the natural surroundings, everything came back to her. Now she is asking, until now it didn't strike her. Now, hearing the words, comforting words from that girl, Chandradevi felt relieved and became more observant. Then noticing the girl's remarkable beauty, her melodious voice, her attractive dress, and her exotic ornaments, she said, Chandramani now inquired, you are so young. Where are you going at this time of the night, wearing such fine ornaments and dress? And what is this strange ornament on your ears? With a smile, the girl said, it is called Kundala. So Kundala is the earrings, is called Kundala. Karna Kundala, it is called Karna Kundala. Karna means ears. Kundala means that earrings which would be hanging like this. That's called Kundala, Karna Kundala. So it was very strange to her. She had not seen such, because she is from a poor family. Where can she see such beautiful ornaments? Now she felt, you see, the nature of generally the mothers and ladies is to inquire about the ornaments. We all can see that it is the natural tendency of the ladies to inquire about the ornaments, especially the Indian mothers. So, noticing the girl's remarkable beauty and melodious voice, her attractive dress and her exotic ornaments, she said, you are so young. Where are you going at this time of the night, wearing such fine ornaments and dress? And what is this strange ornament on your ears? With a smile, the girl said, it is called Kundala. And said, I have yet to go a long distance. Thinking that she was in trouble, Chandra said affectionately, come, my child, rest for the night at our house. See, the heart of simple Lady Chandra telling, now it is dead of the night, don't go anywhere. Come to our hut. Stay in our hut for the night. Then you can take rest. You can take some refreshment. And then you can continue your journey in the morning. So that you can see the heart, tenderness of the heart. So that is Chandradevi. The simplicity of that lady, Chandradevi, who will become the mother of an avatar. So God always wants that simplicity. We become too compound and complex with so many angularities, so many prejudices. So God can't stay in such an heart. So you can see how simple that Mother Chandra Devi is. So you are so young and you may be in trouble. So affectionately, Chandramani Devi is telling, come, my child, rest for the night at our house. Tomorrow you may go at your leisure. So that girl, that beautiful girl with so much of ornament, she replied, no, mother, replied the girl, I must go just now. I will come to your house some other time. I will come to your house some other time, not now. I have to go somewhere else. I have so much of things to do. I must go just now. I will come to you. She promised that I will come to your house some other time. Taking leave of her, she went in the direction of the larger paddy stacks of the Lahas nearby. Nearby, they lived the family of the Lahas. It was a rich businessman family. So the Lahas. So mother, that girl walked towards that paddy stacks. So after going the paddy, this thing will be stacked up near the houses. So in that direction towards the Lahas house, that girl went away. Taking leave of her, she went in the direction of the larger paddy stacks of the Laha nearby. Surprised to see her going towards the house of the Lahas, instead of following the regular path, Chandra thought that she had missed the way. She went after her to guide her, to help her, but could not find her. Now, I have seen in India, when people ask for help, especially to find the way, I have seen the people there, they will not be knowing the language. They may not be the other person who is searching for the path, may be a stranger. They will go out of the way to help them, to take them to their destination. Sometimes they may take in their own vehicle and drop them to their places. Or else sometimes the poor people, when they ask for help to find out the way, if they know that they will go with them, spend the money, go with them, show the path, show the house, and then come back. So that helping nature can be seen even now in such people, simple people. But as we grow complex and other things, we become too sophisticated and that helping nature goes away. Now we can see this Chandramani Devi. Now she's not only saw that the girl is going to not in the regular path, but she's going to towards the house of the Lahas. So she felt maybe she has missed the way. She tried to go behind her, call her back, and wanted to help her to find the right way. This is not the right way, you have to go this way. So the helping nature, in every deed they do, we can see what is their nature. So the character, the simplicity, she wants to help her. She's going back now in the darkness to find that girl and tell her that this is not the path, you have to go this way, this is the right path. So Chandramani Devi went behind her, calling her and trying to find her, but she couldn't find her. She thought she had missed the way. She went after her, but could not find her, though she searched in all directions. Then recalling what the girl had said, it suddenly dawned upon her that she might have seen the goddess Lakshmi. Now, she could think and could understand it was not none other than that girl with such beautiful ornaments, a beautiful face, beautiful beauty, and that melodious voice and the ornaments, everything, that bright light. Now she could understand that it was none other than Mother Lakshmi. Just go back. What did she tell? I have come from the same house where your son Ramakumar had gone to worship. And he's safe. Do not worry. He will be coming. And now she promised that I will come to your house another time. Now I have so many other works to do. I have to go to some other places. So, and she disappeared. Now only she could understand it was Divine Mother Lakshmi who had come here to assuage her because she was anxious. So Mother Lakshmi had come. And can you imagine how that prophecy of that Divine Mother Lakshmi got fulfilled? That I'll come to your house some other time. Yes, how did she come now? As Mother Sharda Devi. We all believe Mother Sharda Devi. If Ramakrishna is Vishnu, then who can Mother Sharda Devi be? Somebody was asking Shardanandaji, who is the author of this book, that was Mother Sharda Devi, an ordinary housewife, would become the wife of this thing, so people were respecting her. Some special incidents also happened in the life of Mother Sharda Devi. Now, Ramakrishna is no more. Now, Sharda Devi has taken up all the spiritual ministration. People would come in thousands to get spiritual ministry from Sharda Devi. Now, they had recognized her as the Divine Mother. They were worshipping her. They used to come to her for solace and succor and get mantra diksha and so many other things. It so happened in Kamapukur, when Mother was there, lots of people were coming, devotees were coming and giving her gifts, fruits, cloths, money and other things. Now one lady who was from Kamapukur was the, of the same age group of Ramakrishna, or maybe little junior to Ramakrishna, was there in that village. Seeing all these things, that lady became a little jealous. So she was telling aloud, the family of Ramakrishna wanted to marry off Ramakrishna to me at that time. At the time when they wanted to marry Ramakrishna, when he came to the age of marriage, when they were searching, they had come to my family to give me in marriage to Ramakrishna. Then because they were very poor, Ramakrishna's family were poor and we were well off, so our parents couldn't give the bridal money. Those time it was not Varadakshina, it was Vadudakshina. So the girl would be married. So the boy's parents had to pay the money. The bridal money had to be paid, and then they had to pay a lot of huge amount of money to the girl's family. That was the custom in those days. Now it has all changed. Now the girl's family has to pay money to the boy's family. But now that is going away. That system is also going away. The government has seen that the dowry and other things should not be done, and it has become a criminal offense now. They can't give money that way now. But still things go on. Let us not worry about that. So this lady was feeling jealous, and she was commenting, telling that loudly, that if Ramakrishna would have married me at that time, because they couldn't pay that bridal money, I couldn't marry. They were poor. Otherwise, Ramakrishna would have married me at that age. Then, if I would have been the wife of Ramakrishna, I would have got all these fruits, I would have got all these cloths, I would have got all this respect and money. So she was feeling jealous. Then Mother Sharda Devi, hearing that, she laughed and told, "Do not worry, my dear child, my dear mother. Why do you worry that you are not married to Ramakrishna? You take away all this gift. Even now, this is yours." Even without a second thought, Mother gave away all the gifts and fruits and other things to that woman. And that woman was so happy and took away all that things to her house, the money, the cloth, all the special new cloths and all the fruit she gave away, Sharda Devi. Then Shardanandaji and other people predict that how can that lady imagine that she could marry Lord Narayana, or Sharda Devi is an ordinary lady by chance or by mistake, because they couldn't pay the bridal money, that Ramakrishna married Sharda Devi. No. It was Sharda Devi who chose Ramakrishna. if you see some of the events in the life, to Sharada Devi who had chosen, she said, the Divine Mother is the power. Everything, this whole world is acting according to the power of the Divine Mother. So, Sharadanandaji comments, has the great Avatar Purusha, the Lord Vishnu, will he marry an ordinary village girl? So Sharada Devi is not an ordinary lady. She is Lakshmi herself. So the prediction there, what did she tell? I will come to your house sometimes later, some other day. And she came to that house. The Divine Mother Lakshmi came in the form of Sharada Devi and stayed there. We all know that. Okay, that's a different thing. Now we shall go forward to see the happenings then. So, Chandra Devi thought, then afterwards, then recalling what the girl had said, it suddenly dawned upon her that she might have seen the goddess Lakshmi. She hastened to her husband and in great excitement told him everything from beginning and to the end, and in great detail she shared it. Again, another aspect of simplicity. Simple people cannot hide anything, no secrets with them. They will share everything with everybody. That is also nature of simplicity. They cannot hide anything. So she shared and explained everything what happened to her husband, Shudhiram, in detail. And hearing the whole account, Shudhiram assured her that there was no doubt that the Divine Mother Lakshmi, Goddess Lakshmi, had graciously revealed herself to her. The Mother Lakshmi herself came and revealed her, Eva Darshan, assuaged her feelings, told that Ram Kumar is coming, you need not worry. Then she went from there. So see, Mother herself, you have not done any tapasya, you have not done any spiritual discipline now. And the Lord, the Goddess herself coming and giving her darshan vision and then talking to her. And now, like a simple child, she started asking, what is that ornament, special ornament on your ears? The mother also replied, that is Kundala, it's called Kundala. Can you imagine all these things? See, because now we are studying that, we also had the vision of Divine Mother Lakshmi. You can imagine all those situations. So that's called Leela Dhyana. I told you, meditation on the sports of the Lord. Now this sport is happening. Now you are visualizing the whole thing. You are imagining. You can imagine that Divine Mother Lakshmi coming there, bedecked with so much of varieties of ornaments, with a beautiful dress, beautiful voice, beautiful face, beautiful form. She's walking and coming towards Chandramani Devi. Everything you can imagine. You can picturize it. So it's meditation on Mother Lakshmi. So today, because we are reading this, Mother Lakshmi came to you, gave you the vision. You had seen, now you have seen the vision, have the darshan of Mother Lakshmi. You've seen how she was bedecked with the jewels and that Karna Kundala, everything, how melodiously she talked, how she assuaged the feeling of Chandramani Devi, all these things. So now she came to your house. Mother Lakshmi has already entered your house, your heart. So by the reading of Ramakrishna's life, even before the advent of Ramakrishna, Lakshmi has come to you. So you should know what is Lakshmi. What is the word? What is the meaning of word Lakshmi? So the word Lakshmi, like all the names of gods and goddesses, there will be some meaning. What is the meaning of Vishnu? It comes from the root word Vishulr, means Vyapunoti, all pervading, who is everywhere. That is the meaning of word Vishnu, all pervasive, who is everywhere. There is no place where he doesn't exist. That is the meaning of Vishnu. We all think Vishnu means we get a form. But in reality, Vishnu means all pervasive. The meaning of Vishnu, it comes from the root word Vishulr, meaning Vyapunoti. So he's all pervasive, everywhere. There is no place where Vishnu doesn't exist. So that is the meaning of Vishnu. Likewise, what is the meaning of Lakshmi? What is the root word from which Lakshmi comes? It comes from the root word Lakshya. What is the meaning of lakshya? What is the meaning of, in Hindi also they use that word lakshya. And other languages too, that word lakshya is there in Indian languages. Lakshyam is goal. So it comes from the root word lakshya. So what is that connected to Lakshmi? Mother Lakshmi giving us wealth, money, property, and all the enjoyments in the life. Now she is the finance minister. See, in our Hinduism, all the three portfolios of the ministry are given to divine mothers only, ladies. Education minister is Mother Saraswati. Finance minister, economy, everything is Mother Lakshmi. Then what about defense minister? Is Mother Durga, defense minister, protection, arms and ammunition, police department, home department, everything is home department also. Home department and defense ministry, everything is Mother Durga. Security, internal security and the external security, everything is Mother Durga. So now the finance minister, Mother Lakshmi, so she gives us wealth, she gives us money, property, enjoyment, everything. Why? So that you have so much of desires. With that desire, you cannot think of your goal. So she will satiate you, giving all this wealth and desire, not to just be immersed in that itself after that. So after getting saturated, after getting satiated with the wealth, with the enjoyments, then you have to turn your mind towards your goal, that is realization of God. That is the lakshya. So to know your real nature, to get God realization, that is the highest goal. That is the lakshya. That's what Swami Vivekananda is telling. Arise, awake, stop not till the goal is reached. What is that goal? The highest goal of human life, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa tells, is God realization, to know your own real nature. So now, Lakshmi means one who is giving you wealth, money, all the enjoyments, and then after getting satiated, after fulfilling all your desires, then so that you may turn your mind to God realization, towards your goal. That is lakshya. That is Lakshmi. So don't think that Lakshmi means always she will be giving you money just for getting something benefit. She's a means to an end. Her only intention is that you should turn towards your goal. What is your goal? God realization. So after knowing that also, why should you wait until mother gives you money and then you get satisfied? You know what is your goal now. What is Mother Lakshmi standing for? That is a real wealth. That is real money. That is real, the costly thing. What did Mirabai tell? Mirabai, that song, you can know that many people sing that, but you will not give your mind towards the meaning. You just sing beautiful music, beautiful lines, that's all. Payo ji maine, Ram Ratana Dhana Payo. Most of you will have heard this song, sung by many people. Payoji maine Ram Ratana Dhan Payo, Meera Bhajan. I got it, Payoji. Ji, oh, people of the world. Maine, my Payoji, I got Ram Ratana, the precious stone, the precious diamond, Ratna. What is that? Costliest Ratna. Not the Kohinoor diamonds on the head of the Queen of England. But Ram Ratan, the nugget, the diamond. Ram Ratan. And what kind of is? What is its value? Other wealth which you have, other diamond and other things, which whatever you have, the costly things, ornaments. You have the fear of thief. Somebody will steal it away. Somebody may take it away. And tax collectors will come and put heavy taxes on that. So the value, your amount in the bank will be reducing and reducing as you keep. It will reduce. And somebody, people will be taking away. You'll be afraid that some thief might come and steal. Some hacker may take away. But what kind of Ram Ratana I have got, the diamond, the costliest thing, the wealth which I have got, Ram Ratana Dhanapayo. Karchaina Kutai Vako Chorna Lutai. How much ever you go on spending, it increases and increases, it will not decrease. Karchaina Kutai Vako. The more you spend it, the more you use that money, Ram Ratan. Spend that, enjoy it. It will become more and more, it will not decrease. The other wealth you have, the worldly wealth, the money you have in the bank, it will reduce as you go on using. Then nobody can steal it. Chorana lutai. The thief cannot steal it. That is the ratna I have got. Rama ratana dhanapayo. So Mother Lakshmi is trying to remind you by giving all these glass beads called diamonds, gold called mud, the mud called gold and other things, the money, valueless paper. You are giving the value to that. All that thing Mother Lakshmi is giving so that you will be satisfied. You will finish off this running after the enjoyment and turn your mind towards goal, that is God realization. Lakshya, who will turn our mind towards Lakshya after satisfying, giving all this wealth. She is called Lakshmi. So now we had that beautiful vision. We saw Mother Lakshmi. She came to our house. She came to our heart because we were studying this wonderful life. And now we will see. So Chandramani, through Chandramani, we had that beautiful thing. So that is what Lakshmi means. So let us all, because of our vision today, turn our minds to our goal, that is God realization. That's what this life, even before his advent, Sri Ramakrishna, we should turn our minds to God realization. That is the goal. It is not too late now. From today itself, we will start, turn our mind towards the goal, getting that goal. So now, Lakshmi Devi, Lakshmi, that goddess Lakshmi had graciously revealed herself to her. Soon after this, Ramakumar returned home and hearing what had happened was filled with wonder. Now the time passed on and it was now AD 1835. Feeling once again a strong urge to go on a pilgrimage. So people in India, they go to pilgrimage. Because there will be concentrated spirituality, there will be presence of the Lord. Then just now you told Vishnu means all pervasive, God is everywhere. Then why should we go to place of pilgrimage? Wherever we are, we can see God. Yes, that's true. But can you see that? Have the capacity to see God everywhere? Then one more thing is there. Just like the milk, the nutrition of the cow, is in the blood of the cow and is all parts of the body of the cow. Can you get that milk, any other part? Can you get it in the horns of the cow or the mouth of the cow or the ear of the cow or the hump of the cow or the tail of the cow? You can get that nutrition, beautiful milk only from the udder of the cow. Isn't it? Like that, God may be everywhere, all pervasive, but his presence is more manifested, is felt, concentrated way. You can find it in places of pilgrimage, in the temples. The Lord has manifested more in certain places. They are called pilgrimages. Like Kashi. Kashi is also called Varanasi, then Haridwar, Gaya, Puri, Jagannatha, Rameshwaram, all the 12 Jyotirlingas, then Shaktipitas, Divine Mother's places. Now Belur Mutt has also become a pilgrimage. Jairam Bhati, Kamarpukur has become pilgrimage. Likewise, there are so much of places where the Lord's presence is concentrated. Just like you get the milk from the udder of the cow, like that pilgrimage, though the Lord is everywhere, he will find him more. So people of India, they would aspire to go to the pilgrimages so that they can feel the presence of God. They can bring it back and they can do more sadhana with that meditation. What is the use of going to pilgrimage? Ramakrishna used to tell, when you go to the pilgrimages, you have to see the Lord there, have the vision of the Lord there, the image and all that places of worship. Keep it in your mind. Just like the cow will go and graze the grass everywhere, then it will come back to the house, in the shed, it will be sitting, you can see it will be chewing something like this, moving the mouth. So it will store in one duplicate or some this thing, extra stomach, and it will bring it back again, chew it nicely, because it may not get food all the time. So whenever it gets, it will just eat, take that grass and store it somewhere inside, and then bring it back, sit there leisurely. It will chew it nicely and send it to the proper stomach for digestion. So likewise, giving this example, Ramakrishna tells, when you go to different pilgrimages, you have to see, notice, to study beforehand, come to know about that pilgrimage, everything, study, look and keep it in your mind. Then after coming back from the pilgrimage, you have to meditate on that. You have seen the image there. You had the vision of the Lord there. So many things happened. You recollect everything. Then cogitate on that. So achieving the cut, bringing back that memories. So that is the use of the pilgrimage. That is the thing you had to do in the pilgrimage. You should not go for pilgrimage to buy new saris, new cloths and new vessels for purchase, for marketing. After going to pilgrimage, we'll go to some market there, mall or something, to get something. We are not bothered about what you have seen there. What is the vision? What you do you have? One Harikatha Das was telling a humorous story. People go to the pilgrimage. They elbow each other. So much of rush, so much of people. They push. They go inside somehow, do something, see the image there. Then they come back, get some prasad. They get some tilak and eat the prasad. Coming out of the temple, they will ask the other person there, what is the name of the deity inside? What was the deity inside? They do not know what the deity is here. They have gone, they elbowed, pushed, ate the prasad, put on the tilak, everything. After coming back, now they are asking, what is the deity inside? What is the god inside? Inside the temple, inside the sanctum, what was that god? So that's our situation. So we are not going for marketing for pilgrimage. But Ramakrishna is telling what you should do after going to pilgrimage. First of all, your mind should be focused on what is that mahima, the manifestation, what was the leela, what was the play of the Lord, divine sport of the Lord there? Why is it called that special pilgrimage there? What has happened? What was all the manifestation of the Lord? That's called mahima. What has happened there? Everything you have to study beforehand, afterhand. You have that vision. Think of the things, events happened there. Keep it in your mind. Then come back. Then recollect all the photos, everything, memory you had. Picturize it and bring it back. Meditate on that. So it's for meditation. That is the thing you have to do in pilgrimage. Ramakrishna tells it, that is the way of doing pilgrimage. So now we have come to know what is pilgrimage. What should we do in pilgrimage? Not marketing. Okay, you can keep little marketing to bring something as memory. But that you can do that marketing here too. You will be doing a lot of marketing here too. But don't go for pilgrimage for marketing and other things. This spiritual benefit is important thing. So now, Kshudiram, feeling once again a strong urge to go on a pilgrimage, Kshudiram decided to go to Gaya to perform rites for the redemption of the spirits of his forefathers. He was now 60 years old. His age was 60. Still, he had no hesitation to proceed on foot to the holy abode of Vishnu. Who is there? What is the pilgrimage? What is the manifestation of the deity in Gaya? It is Lord Vishnu. It is divided. One is Vishnu Gaya, where the original Gaya is. And a little away from that is Bodh Gaya, where Lord Buddha, in that same place, did a lot of meditation under the Bodh tree or people tree and attained illumination. So that portion, that Bodh tree, the temple of Buddha where he attained illumination, is still maintained. That is called Bodh Gaya, where Buddha got illumination. But even before that site was worshipped for Vishnu, and that is Vishnu Gaya. What is the special feature of Vishnu Gaya? What is the deity I told you, Vishnu and Gaya? So let me tell in detail, because now we have only 3 or 4 minutes left. So if I can't go for the details of what is Vishnu Gaya, tell about Vishnu Gaya, I will give you a detailed description of Gaya in the next class. Before that, I just wanted to share one poem written by one small girl in India, in Mayapur. So it's very beautiful. What is that poetry about? It's the poetry is about the quarantine. Now we are undergoing this lockdown and quarantine. So she has written, that girl, a young girl, has written a poem on that quarantine. It's so beautiful. See her imagination and see the way she thinks and how everything can be converted. See, that is a speciality. How even calamity can be converted into spiritual life. So I will read that. A great poem. A young girl, Nandini, in Mayapur, wrote this. So what is that poetry? May I be quarantined in the heart of Sri Sri Radha Madhava. May I be quarantined in the heart of Sri Sri Radha Madhava. Madhava means lover. Radha's lover is Lord Krishna. For the rest of eternity, not for 2 months or 1 month or 15 days, the quarantine, but that girl is telling, may I be quarantined in the heart of Sri Sri Radha Madhava for the rest of eternity. May they have me locked down beneath, may they have me locked down beneath their reddish lotus feet for the rest of eternity. The reddish lotus feet of Lord Krishna's, the Lord's lotus feet for eternity. She wants the lockdown and quarantine for eternity. So the quarantine is in the heart of Lord Krishna, and the lockdown is, she should be locked at the feet, the reddish lotus feet of Lord Krishna for eternity, keeping me safe from the virus of, what is the virus here? It is not corona. Keeping me safe from the virus of illusion. Keeping me safe from the virus of illusion. May they increase my immune system by giving me the vitamins of their service. So how can I increase my immunity? Immune system, increase my immune system by giving me the vitamins of Lord Krishna's, the Lord's service. This is an order from the government of my heart. This is an order from the government of my heart to the citizens of my mind during the lockdown period, which will extend till the existence of the soul. What a wonderful concept. The beautiful way to turn the whole calamity, the problem pandemic, into a beautiful spiritual venture. And what is the hand sanitizer? Let me use the hand wash called sincerity. Let me use the hand wash called sincerity to cleanse me of the germs of superficiality. This should be done as many times in the day as possible for at least 20 seconds as per the time of Lord Brahma. So let me use the hand wash called sincerity to cleanse me of the germ of superficiality. Let me keep great distance from the people called lust, anger, pride and hypocrisy, who have arrived from a foreign land full of virus. Let me at the least keep 2 meter distance of anger from anyone who sneezes and coughs out harsh words against you or your devotees, O Lord Krishna. There is still more thing because I've already completed 8 o'clock. So I will read that poem in the next session. So we will end this session now, because we have completed the time. So if you have any question, if you have any doubts about today's discussion, you can please ask. There is still more poem that is not completed. I will read that poem in the next class. If you have any questions, if you have any doubts, I can entertain that for about 2-3 minutes. We have completed 8 o'clock already. We started it today a little bit late.
Pranam Maharaj.
Yes, mother.
All your teachers are so wonderful, so beautiful, that we are absolutely in love. And we look forward to sharing this process every day. I'm Vandana Sarkar, and my husband is Kapil Sarkar. So, Maharaj,
we eagerly and ardently look forward to your discussion.
Every day.
I will. I will. Yeah, by God's grace, it will happen. Divine Mother willing, everything will happen. Thank you very much.
We are absolutely privileged, Maharaj. Thank you so much for getting such enlightenments in all the areas, like the significance of puja and all of that.
Very, very, very all-rounded approach you have taken.
And
for enlightenment.
Beautifully explained.
Credit goes to Divine Mother Sharda Devi and Ramakrishna. Nothing is mine. I am just an instrument in the hands. So they are allowing me to do that. That's all. I am very grateful that this instrument is being used to the service of all the devotees.
Yes, Maharaj. Thank you so much. I will pronounce to you.
So, because now we are exceeding our time, I will close the session with the prayer. Because people have a lot of work to do, they have to go to different works, they have a lot of work. So I will end the session with a prayer. Thank you, everyone. Namaskar to all of you. So I will tell the prayer, ending prayer. Om Priyatam Pundarikakshah Sarvayagneshwaro Harihi Tasmin Stushte Jagat Tushtam Prinite Prinitam Jagat हरि ओम तत्सत् श्री राम कृष्णार्पणमस्तु ओम नमो नारायणाय जय राम कृष्ण आई थिंक टुमारो अगेन वी विल बी मीटिंग एट द सेम टाइम दैट इज 6:30 द मॉर्निंग दैट इज साउथ अफ्रीकन टाइम एंड इंडिया इट इज 10 o'clock विद द सेम सब्जेक्ट वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग टुमारो दैट इज फ्राइडे देन सैटरडे इवनिंग वी हैव भगवद गीता क्लास Then Sunday again we'll be meeting in the morning for the same session that is Ramakrishna the great master. Monday also we'll be meeting. Monday evening we have the puja class at 6 o'clock, and then Tuesday we have Vivek Chudamani. Wednesday we have Bhagavad Gita. Then again Thursday we'll be meeting back on the same day. So all are welcome to all this meeting. Thank you. Namaste. Jai Ramakrishna.